Oh, I'm Sean, and it's a real pleasure to be here. I'm delighted to be invited to try and say something new about Grambank in front of all the people that made it and have been thinking about it for 10 years. So in my desperation to find something to say, I have turned to magic, and I'm going to use, through a process of divination, I'm going to try and make some predictions about the future of Grambank. So you will know the future of Grambank by these signs. The web of causal relations, the iceberg of analysis, the tower of support, and the zombie of hypotheses. So what am I talking about? First one, my first prediction about the future, which is probably everyone here is on the same page with all of this stuff, I kind of now realize. But I'm going to very helpfully, the paper I'm going to talk about was just covered by Elena. And it's this idea that the number of people who speak a language affects its morphological complexity. And it's based on theories like work like this and many others by Lupian and Dale. So, for example, the number of L1 speakers affects the number of L2 speakers and the amount of contact. And those things tend to simplify the morphology. That's the hypothesis. But then there's the finding that there's only a weak positive relationship between L1 and boundedness. So now what? Well, I think one of the interesting things is one of the methods that are used in this paper is a process of bottom-up regression. So they run a load of different regressions with different combinations of variables. And identify the one that explains the variation in morphological boundedness the best. And I just want to think a little bit about that strategy. So I'm not going to refute anything in the paper. I just want to think about the general strategy going forward. So for example, let's say that the structure of the world is really like this, that contact and L2 speakers and L1 speakers, they all affect boundedness and they're not affected by each other. In this case, the sort of bottom-up regression approach is a good approach, and the regression should pick up all of these effects. But actually, this isn't what Lupian and Dale's hypothesis is. Their hypothesis is more like this, that the L1 speakers affect L2 speakers, and L2 speakers affect boundedness. So if we were using a bottom-up regression, and L2 speakers was part of that regression, it would tend to not select the L1 speakers. Because if this is the real structure of the world, there should be no correlation between L1 speakers and boundedness, except for the effect on L2 speakers. I think obviously L2 speakers is the thing that explains boundedness, but I don't think that means that L1 speakers aren't part of the story, aren't part of the hypothesis. So what can we do about that? And then there might be different kinds of hypotheses. That, for example, the L1 speakers affect word length, and boundedness might affect word length. And in fact, these are two hypotheses that have been proposed. And in the raw data, the correlations are as we would expect. But in this kind of situation, this is a collider structure, which means that if we included word length in a regression, then there'd be a spurious correlation between L1 and boundedness in the regression that wasn't really causal. And actually, none of these things explain the results in the paper. I'm not saying they do. But thinking about what the possible structure of the world is might affect the way that we do things. And as well as a bottom-up approach, we might want to take a top-down approach, starting with the hypotheses and working from there. So that's what I'm suggesting. The first prediction is that we're going to move more from trying to explain the variation in one variable to try and explain the web of connections between things. And one useful thing, if we were going to do that, is a database of hypotheses expressed as causal graphs. And this is what I've been working on with many different people, many of you in the audience today. So what I did is I took 21 different hypotheses about how L1 speakers affect boundedness. And this is very complicated, but it gives us a starting point for thinking about the different hypotheses. And what I realized is that there's three types of hypotheses. There are external mechanisms like L2 learners. There are language internal mechanisms, like the amount of phonological variation or word length. And then there are contact mechanisms between languages. Those are the three general things. And actually, we can measure some of this stuff. So we can create a sort of a causal graph of hypotheses that represents several different hypotheses with stuff that we can measure. So I went to get the data that Olena was talking about and collected some more data on phonological variation and word length, quite badly, just for this thing. I'm using a slightly different measure of isolation to them. And then ran this as a in BRMS as a path analysis controlling for phylogenetic relatedness using the same edge tree that was in that previous paper. And here's the results. So I found significant relationships between L1 speakers and several of the sort of middle predictors here. But none of these middle predictors help explain morphological boundedness. So this is quite in line with the previous paper. And also confusing given all the previous hypotheses. And in fact, there's worries about collinearity here. So if you run the right-hand side as a set of individual models, the only significant correlation is with morphological boundedness and word length, which is an interesting part of the thing. And there's also other hypotheses that link word length to word order, and other hypotheses that link word order to population size. So this web is getting bigger and bigger. But I think this is a kind of way of at least approaching these kind of questions by trying to figure out, not just focusing on a single variable, but trying to explain the sort of wider web of things. And I know people are doing this. But it leads to my second prediction, which is the iceberg. So I've found myself working on lots of projects recently, and there are lots of people here who may feel the same thing, that there's an enormous amount of work that goes into just getting the data and setting up the analyses. And in the end, after you've sort of done all this a huge amount of work, what you get at the surface is the sort of, well, there's probably nothing there. So I just want to think about how do we deal with this on a kind of like an emotional level, but also telling scientific stories. How do we make this a story that seems like science? Because there's lots of papers like this. So for example, this previous paper suggested that the humidity of the air affects the number of tones a language is used. So I've been working with these people recently to try and test that. We have a geographic phylogenetic tree of Bantu. We took the current number of tones in languages from Froebel, and we have this historical climate model. So now we can actually figure out the humidity at specific points in time and space in the tree. And then we create a custom stand model to try and ask whether languages gain tones when their populations move into humid regions. So basically just simulating thousands of years of history over an entire continent. And what did we find? There's probably no relationship, which is kind of frustrating. Although you might remember this paper a while ago, the idea that if you speak a pro-drop language, you're less autonomous because you use the word I less. And that means that you're less likely to go to university. Me and James Winters were trying to do this and trying to control for history. But for this workshop, we reran all of this with the Grambank data. We had to use this at the country level. We wanted to model the idea that countries have multiple language families, multiple language histories in them. So we had to use a multi-membership mixed effects model, which is so complicated, I mistyped it here. And when you do that, then the effects go away. There's also individual level data. And we happen to actually be able to measure individual persons' autonomy through a survey. And actually, if you do this, there is a negative relationship between pro-drop and investment, but the individual correlations of the individual steps in the causal graph are the opposite of what was predicted in the theory. So we don't know what to do with this story because there's a relationship, but it doesn't fit with the hypothesis, which is the opposite of the previous paper. What's going on? I like this quote from Richard McElrath, who says, there's a time when charting of linguistic variation produced many surprising discoveries, but we're now in the long, hard slog of understanding. So what do we do? And I think part of what we should be thinking about is how to tell this story. And one of the solutions might be to highlight methods over discoveries, to highlight the questions over the answers. The fact that we can ask these questions about human history is amazing. And that might be part of the story that we want to tell. All right, my next prediction is connected to this, because I wanted to do some reanalyses of the data, and the data is online. So I went online, I'll just download the data and rerun some analyses. But before I could do that, I needed to install 300 R libraries. And after that, I needed to go through 25,000 lines of R code. Just for this one paper, depended on all of this stuff. So my prediction, academic research is now software engineering in a lot of cases. And one of the things we might have to think about is that our work stands on a tower of libraries and other people's work. How are we going to support people to be able to use all of this stuff? It was challenging. Actually, I didn't manage to install all of the libraries. I couldn't do it. And how do we support people who maintain this? So it's amazing to see that there was a workshop before this to show people how to use the stuff. There are lots of summer schools teaching people methods who want to use this stuff, who have the linguistic background, but not the statistical background. And we're designing a course at the moment, which is dealing with data, which our department has the head of research in my department had never heard of supplementary materials. And yet we still recognize that this is an important part of the future of linguistics. So we're going to spend more time doing this. And it's great to see the CLLD sort of group as a support for developers. But we might need to start thinking of how do we support those 300 libraries? What if one of them goes away? Do our results and research go away? So the final thing I want, my prediction is the zombie. And this is something that we might be contending with more in the future. One of the great things about Grambank is you can link data between different things. We have data at language level, but there are loads of global surveys of individuals and which languages they speak. So you can link that. And we've been working recently on linking the World Value Survey to Glottolog language codes, which is not a straightforward thing, to be able to link these. And then linking individual where people live to the countries that they live. And then we have economic and political data as well. And this is going to become more common, I think. And I'm just going to tell you a little story about how I failed to manage the zombie hordes, in this case, with work on future tense and economic decisions. And this is with all of these people, particularly Cole Robertson, who did his PhD on this stuff. So 10 years ago, Keith Chen, who's an economist, came up with this proposal that obligatory grammatical distinction between future and present makes you use the future tense more. And so the future seems further away. The rewards seem less worth it. So you're more likely to make a choice based on the here and now rather than some larger reward later on. James Winters and I and Keith Chen collaborated to show that controlling for language family reduces this effect. And nobody listened to us, so we published the same paper recently again. And what's been happening over the last 10 years is this. So if someone writes a paper saying, oh, the future tense predicts this economic thing, it gets sent to me for review. And I say, okay, well, you've interpreted Chen's theory incorrectly. There are no citations for the linguistic stuff, and there's no control for linguistic history. So what they do is they sort of revise the paper, they cite Austin Dahl, and then they say future studies should control for blah. And then someone sees this paper and think, oh, I could do that. I've got this variable. Future tense might predict this other thing. I write a review saying there's all these three things, and they adjust the paper. And this keeps happening. So these are all papers now that basically do the same thing, that we know future tense correlates with risky decisions. And this is sort of like a zombie hypothesis. it's very difficult to kill this. But for us, I think there's a slightly different things going on. Why is this happening? First of all, because the economists can access the data. Keith Chen published the data, which countries have an obligatory future tense, which is a very badly formed bit of data. And it's easy to link to things. Economists really deal with variables that have long autocorrelation times. Things change very quickly in the world of economics, and they just don't appreciate that language variables can change over such long periods of time, which is why all the work on Grambank showing all the sort of the role of phylogeny is so important. And there's a lack of linguistics knowledge, just like in between any fields. So there's not a clear understanding that there's more than one language per country. There's not a clear understanding that people can speak two languages, or that grammars are more complex than just do they yes or no kind of thing. So all the work, I think, that is being done around Grambank is very important to try and make it clear how complicated these issues are. But I think one of the steps to, you can't kill the zombie like this until you make it easier for economists to do something else other than just take the old stuff and redo the correlations. So what we did is try and do some experiments based on the grammatical theory. And this is Cole Robertson's PhD. So Keith Chen had this idea that it's about future tense. Cole suggested it's not about tense, it's about modality. So in English, if I say, I will go to the party tomorrow, that's a statement about the future, but it's also a very confident statement. It's about a statement about probability. Now, I could have said, I might go to the party, or I'll probably go to the party, or something like that. So the grammar of future reference in English is much more complicated and might involve a lot of low certainty language use, like might, could, would. So what we did is we got a load of people who speak English and Dutch. We gave them writing tasks to figure out how much they actually use the future tense or how much they use different strategies. We gave them a perception task to see how far away they thought time was, different points in time were. And we gave them an economic task. Would you like 10 euros now or 15 euros in a week? Which is a standard task in economics. And what we found is this. So first of all, the people who use the future tense a lot, that doesn't predict their sort of subjective temporal distance. So Keith Chen, that sort of crucial step of Keith Chen's hypothesis isn't borne out in the data. But English speakers use more uncertain language than Dutch speakers. And people who use more uncertain language have lower subjective values. So we can actually predict what, if we know the language that they speak, and the amount that they use these different strategies, we can predict their economic decisions. In the sort of broad thrust of what Chen was suggesting, but now much more specific in terms of the actual linguistics of what we should be looking at. And recently we repeated this with Dutch English bilinguals. So we got bilinguals and we did the same experiment a week apart. And again, depending on the language that we do the experiment in, they actually change their judgments about the economic things. So this is kind of evidence that is interesting to economists and hopefully makes them more interested in relevant linguistic properties. So now we can go back to the grammars. Now we're interested in going back and trying to figure out, well, can we explain this again on a global scale? And actually in Grambank, there isn't a variable that gets at exactly what we want. But I think one of the great things about Grambank is that is these procedures. So it's very, very explicit how to collect more of this data, how this data was collected. And for us, it means that we can take this and adapt it to the kind of questions that we want to know about language and collect our own data from there. So that was for predictions. I think we're going to do more causal thinking. I think we're going to start talking about methods over discovery, and particularly valuing that stuff in terms of careers and hiring stuff. Contributing to Grambank often doesn't appear in prestigious ways on your CV. We need to think about that kind of thing. The same with support, supporting users and developers. Teaching stuff is really, really important, and we should be valuing that. And then finally, we're going to do lots more collaboration with people that we might not agree with. So those are my four things. These are more sort of my hopes and fears, of course, as any good tarot reveals. And I'm interested in talking more about this stuff. I'm just going to leave you with one mysterious fifth prediction, that grammatical features are more likely to be present in the future. This is a suggestion by Andrew Buskell, and it's borne out in Grambank data. The later the grammar was produced, the more features are present. Thanks.